Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I'd like to call the December 19th meeting of the Alamance County Commissioners to order. And if you will, please join me in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight thanking you for all you've done for us this year. You've been so generous to us in this country. And Lord, as we go into the season of Christmas, please be with our service people overseas. And those that are here, be with our law enforcement and also be with all of our first responders during this holiday season and throughout the year. Thank you, God, for all you've done for us and help us to make good decisions for our county. These things we ask in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. And to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right. First order of business, public speakers. And Mr. Cox, I think you're our public speaker tonight.
As a private citizen, I will say Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Same to you.
I get to do that.
That's right.
And everybody else can just say, yeah. You know, it's amazing the places that I go around to and people say Merry Christmas, but people that work in those places can't say Merry Christmas. They got to say Happy Holidays. Something's wrong with that in the United States of America. But, I don't know. I was going to do some stuff tonight, but I'm going to wait on Tim over here.
Tim's not going to be here. He's
right.
Yeah. He's taking a night.
I'll wait till the next one.
Safe.
I'm hopeful going forward. I am hopeful. One of the things I'm hopeful of is settling this mess with the county here. Very complex. Going to get more complex. But all I was doing was trying to run my business in the United States of America. And a bunch of vigilantes, that's what they was, vigilantes, came into this room and lied like they did. But I was having a conversation with the editor at the Times News, and he asked me, I was talking about some newspaper articles that was done last year, and he said, well, Mr. Cox, do you got a lawyer? I said, no, I don't need a lawyer. You got one? Appears a couple times to people that over there might have needed a lawyer, because they ain't there no more. But when media and government get together to do bad things to private citizens who are just asking for justice, something's wrong with that. But you know, with these documents I got, we get into mail fraud and all kinds of stuff. When you start sending documents over there to Raleigh and you start making false accusations and then investigations happen as a result of it, it's 2014. I do wonder what part did John Paisley have in it, because he was a commissioner then. And then you go to last year, well, earlier this year when I found out about all the stuff that happened in 14 and then the stuff that happened in 15, I say, boy, more lies. File closed, no calls, ain't done nothing wrong. But you've seen that a lot, ain't you, Bill? Unfortunately, just think how much further ahead we could be. I could have done paid possibly millions of dollars in sales tax. People think a junkyard is a junkyard. They have no idea, do they, Mr. Bird? They have no idea, do they?
I do.
Thank you.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
To you, sir.
Merry Christmas.
All right. And there's no more commissioner responses. Hearing none, I ask for a motion for the approval of the agenda, and we need to add a couple of items to that.
We do have two public hearings we need to add on that as well. And again, we apologize for that they did not get placed in minute track. However, they were advertised duly, and they were called for back in November.
And where are we going to put those, Craig?
We could put that first if you want.
Okay.
I guess 7 or
7,
yeah.
1A.
Yes, sir.
We'll make it 1A and B. Okay.
I move approval of the agenda with that revision.
I second that.
All right. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Very good. All right. Moving on to the consent agenda. Is there anything there that we need to pull or look at? Is everybody okay with all of that?
I move approval of the consent agenda.
A second.
Okay. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Very good. All right. Well, now we're going to have the public hearing. I guess we need to make a motion to go into that. I'll make a motion that we go into the public hearing.
I'll second that.
All right. Thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Now,
Libby,
make your presentation, and we'll see if we have folks here to talk about it.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity to present the ordinances again and to have the public hearing. The first one on the list is the Alamance County Height Restriction Ordinance, and you should all have a copy in front of you. It's the same ordinance we presented previously when we called for the public hearing. These changes are in response to the extension of the runway at the Burlington Municipal Airport. And Mr. Daniel is here, the Executive Director. If you have any particular questions about it.
Have you had any feedback from the public about them?
No, sir.
Have you heard anything, Dan?
Aren't aware of what all those consist of. It's pretty complicated, except for our brother, Mr. Danley.
It is very complicated. Ms. Hodges has worked on it very faithfully with.
Are you familiar with everything?
Yes, ma'am.
Or do you agree with everything that she's recommending?
I certainly do. Thank
well, these changes were recommended by the airport authority. They
Okay.
were not. They were not spearheaded by the planning department. We were just asked to take it through the process.
Okay.
This is our request, and it's based on the runway having been extended. The old regulations.
Okay. Any other questions? Ready? Feel good with what we've heard and the same in the package? All right, with that, well, we'll see if we have anyone from the audience that would like to speak to the situation. Everybody's quiet tonight. That's a good thing, right? Okay. Very good. With that, then, I'll ask for a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. Now we need to vote upon it.
And that one, you do have a copy in front of you there for your signatures, if you'd like to do that now.
Right.
Or tonight, not now.
Thank you. We will. We'll take care of that.
We do need to take a vote on
right.
Approval. Yes, sir.
I will make a motion that we adopt the new ordinances.
A second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
And don't forget, I need to get you to sign those before we leave tonight. All right. That's for everybody. Okay.
We got one more.
We have one more, yeah. These are changes to the subdivision ordinance, the Alamance County subdivision ordinance, I guess I should say. It started as a request from our health department. Stacy's here if you have any particular questions, but the request was to add a statement that could go on plats related to the new engineered option for septic systems that the state passed. So that they have the proper statement on the plat that says this has an engineered option and it's been approved. The second part, we went through and fixed a couple of typos that were kind of confusing in the subdivision ordinance. And the planning board also asked that we align the requirement for the technical review committee with when you hit the threshold for requiring a public road in a subdivision. So it used to be that once you got over 14 or over lots, you had to go to a public road, but you didn't have to go to the technical review committee until you got to 20 lots. And this kind of pulls everything all into order so that it's a lot easier to administer.
Using the 14 or the 20?
The 14.
14 is the threshold now.
Right. So as soon as you hit that threshold where you have to have a public road, you'll also go to the technical review committee, which is a committee that's pulled together of concerned development review partners, including the NCDOT, so that they have kind of an early insight.
Fire people and everybody else.
Fire everybody. Anybody who has an interest in looking at a development, including the Home Builders Association.
Right. Okay, so we need to go into public hearing on this also. Is that correct?
I'll make the motion.
All right, thank you.
I thought we were in public hearing.
Well, we closed. Well, we got to do two now because this is a different agenda item. Actually, it's a two item.
A second motion.
Okay, thanks, Bill. Thanks, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Anyone here that would like to speak to this? Tony?
I'm going to have to remind everybody about, about 3 years ago, there was a meeting on this exact same thing here. And it got really contentious then. I think if the people out there knew what this was about tonight, that they'd have some issues about it again tonight, too. Matter of fact, somebody, a woman, had tried to do something on her property. And she was told that she had to do something that she didn't have to do. You remember that?
I don't remember that. Specific detail.
Right, but
I will hear that.
I think her name was King. I could be wrong, but it was saying that she had to have more road than what she was having to have. I can get that recording. I'd say put this off for a minute.
Well, the thing is, was it because of the lots? I wasn't here. I don't even know what you're talking about.
It was because of the width.
The width of the road.
Yeah, EMT come in here, fire department.
We voted at that time.
Y'all voted down.
We voted it down.
Right.
That's right.
Exactly. So, it was real contentious back then.
Yeah.
There was a lot of stuff involved with it because it was going to mess with a bunch of small property owners that was just doing like
that was that specific location. This covers blankets the whole county.
I think what really got people into it. I'm sorry. I think what really got people into it was like people that family members when they was trying to add a house to a property or something. Now, not exact, but it was along them lines. Then they were going to have to go up and do these more standards and cost a lot more money versus a developer going in and doing a subdivision.
Well, this is simplifying that situation.
This is also increasing from 4 to 14 lots.
That was the typo. It should have been. It was supposed to be 4, and it said 20.
Right.
So that was the old threshold for the technical review committee, is that when it went to 20 lots, you go to technical review. Mm-hmm. So this isn't changing any of the standards for private roads at all. Or any
all it's saying is that the threshold is changing.
I was just bringing that to the attention, not for...
Yeah. Is it the threshold is 4 or 14?
14.
14.
Yeah, 4 was the typo. I don't know where that
Yeah, that shouldn't
must it come from the 14?
Yes,
yeah, so part.
I can't speak to that.
Okay.
But this does not change any lot standards. It doesn't change road frontage standards. It doesn't say change private road standards. 14 was already the standard to go to a public road. This just pulls the technical review committee in line.
Starting technical review.
And I personally think that's important.
Oh, I do too. Yeah.
And just to be sure that this was properly advertised,
yes.
So people did have notice.
She's got it with her right here.
You got newspaper ads.
I've seen it.
It was a
couple of days. Been on the website since November 22nd.
Yeah. You had to run it a number of days, so I've seen it in the paper. Yeah.
Right. And I apologize for that oversight. I take complete responsibility for that. Holiday hit.
Anyone else like to speak to this? Okay. Hearing nobody else, I'll take a motion to go out of public hearing.
Second.
Amy, I heard you first. Bill, thank you.
Okay.
Amy and Bill, all in favor?
Aye.
All right. Now we need to do a vote on this amendment to the ordinance.
I move we adopt the amended ordinance.
Okay.
I'll second that.
Bob, thank you. Bill, all in favor?
Aye.
And I'll get a copy of that one. Formatting issues on that one. That's all I have.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
That's all you have.
Thank you,
okay.
Sir.
Good deal.
Thank you.
All right. Thank
you. All right. Next, we have Jeremy. You're next on the list here.
We have a unique situation. Typically, solar equipment is eligible to be taxed at 20% of its true value, 80% being exempt. Earlier this year, there was an application for said exemption, and I was going to deny it because the equipment was not in production. And there is something we call CIP, which is construction in progress. And when a business lists their equipment, if they list it as CIP, what they're telling us is that they have it in their ownership, but it's still in the box. It's nothing that they're currently using. Well, the solar equipment is still in the box. The business asserts that it doesn't have to be in production to be eligible for exemption. Our understanding is that it does. Well, the unique thing about this case is just when I began to kind of dig in and research to make sure that my understanding was correct, a statewide email went out from Department of Revenue. That made my trouble a little bit less. The DOR went on record saying that no, we're getting these from counties across the state, and no, if it's in CIP, it is not eligible. It has to be in production. The request from DOR is that they see these appeals coming through local boards and going to the state board. They want to take all the appeals, unify them at the state level, and they'll actually represent. Now, usually if we go down to the state, it's going to be Clyde, and I'm going to be down there. This is going to be a state action with the DOR representing for all the counties. In this case, you have an appeal. We would normally either wait for the next meeting of the Board of ENR, or we'd hold a special session to bring them back in and look at it. I just think it's most expedient to bring it before this board because they're kind of in a hurry to get them and get them consolidated. There should be a letter in your packet from the appellant. There should be the email from the DOR where they state their position. To me, this is open to shut. If DOR is going to confirm my understanding, if the other counties are going to stand behind it unified, that's our position as an office. If it's not in production, it's not eligible for exemption. The appellant is basically said, just go ahead and do the formality. We want to talk to the state about it. And I said, well, we'll put you on the agenda. What I'm asking for is the board to support this denial of exemption so they can appeal onto the state level.
You say the consensus of the board, or is this a voting issue?
It's a simple vote.
Well, the request was for a public hearing, and you're recommending that we not have a public hearing.
Is it for a public hearing?
Well,
no.
It shouldn't be. This is basically operating as an appeal. The Board of County Commissioners standing as the Board of Equalization.
Well, this says on behalf of our client pursuant to the statute, we hereby appeal the county's denial of the application for property tax exclusion and request a hearing before the Board of Commissioners.
That's what this is. What they're actually requesting is not a public hearing in the sense of what we just had. Mm-hmm. This is an appeal process. If they thought that this was important, and not to say that in a negative way, I understand their position entirely, then their representative would be right here presenting their case.
I was just getting ready to ask, the fact anybody that they don't, here to represent this?
Yeah, they're not appearing in any of the counties that I'm aware of. They want to go before the state. They just consider it a formality. And so if they're not even going to show up to the meeting, I just put them on the agenda And if they want their day at the state, they can have their day at the state, but...
Well, he says also in the last paragraph, please advise us when the hearing before the board will be scheduled, so...
Yes.
I think that's an expectation, but I don't necessarily agree with doing that.
But is that the board?
Well, and that's already been done.
Or...
Yeah. Well, what that is, and this operates in the same way that the Board of Equalization operates every year, but rather than calling a special meeting of the board, Board of Commissioners has the same authority as the Board of Equalization. Theirs is derived from the Board of Commissioners. What he's requested is to come for and have the case heard, and then to be advised as to when that will be. He's been advised both by mail and by email, confirmed that he is aware of the time, confirmed he's not going to be here, and he's not here.
The last sentence says, although our client may decide to appear in person, if it does not, we would appreciate it if you would ask the commissioners to rule on our appeal without the necessity for a personal appearance. So I think the attorney anticipates us finding in favor of the tax administrator and
moving it on to Raleigh and let him.
Mm-hmm. One question I had is that he cites the general statute.
Sure.
Statute. So I looked that up. It doesn't say anything about the taxing the equipment during this construction and process, mm-hmm. but later on in his letter, he says, under North Carolina law, the exclusion applies to such equipment during the construction phase, but he doesn't cite what law that is.
Well, and that's having spoken to him just over the phone. We had a pre-meeting consultation, which is normal practice. He has a very interesting interpretation of the law, and I'm actually very satisfied to see that go to the state level, because whatever we do, we need to do consistently. It shouldn't be one rule in one county, one rule in another county.
Yeah.
And what he's ultimately raising is an interpretation of law that, if it's going to apply countywide, probably, they're probably taking the right approach, trying to take it directly to the state. I'm not sure that I agree with his assertion. I don't know that I find it to be well supported. But I'm more than happy with the DOR's recommendation, the other counties coming on board, to say we're going to pass the ball and say all the counties are standing over here, multiple solar companies are standing over here, and it may go just to the state, it may go into the Court of Appeals. I'm not exactly sure what its destiny is. It's a tremendous amount of tax revenue statewide, and usually when the dollar figure gets to a certain point, it will just keep running until the party will either win and or the next court won't take it. So.
I make a motion that the commission find in favor of the tax department and uphold the denial of victim status.
I'll second that.
Okay, thank you, Amy. Thank you, Bill, and I'm right with you on that. All right.
We have a motion. Second. It's a public matter.
Pardon me?
I object. It's a public matter.
We represent the public. We represent the public.
It's supposed to be an open meeting. That's the problem that I've got right here, right now.
It's not.
It's quasi-judicial proceedings.
What'd you say, Clyde?
Taxpayer represented by counsel.
Yeah.
Got the letter in the packet.
Yeah. So, and his counsel did not show up tonight, and there is nothing being a public hearing, so... We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Very good. Thank you, Jeremy. All right. Finance Department. Susan.
Susan, how you doing?
I'm doing well. I hope you are. Good evening, Commissioners. What I have before you tonight is a request to amend our contract for our annual audit and to extend that out until January 31st, 2017. We have had, due to the additional time and internal resources that are needed to confirm, reconcile, and report the federal and state grants on the schedule of expenditures of federal and state awards for the fiscal year 2016 audit. There were some additional state mandates that were issued at a later time, and this will allow our auditors to get those statements completed, and this just to comply with LGC guidelines.
Okay.
All right, so move.
Thank you, Bob. I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
All right.
And And again, it's nothing we've done on our end as far as any delay. It's a statewide issue, and I appreciate the work that Susan and her staff's done to get us to this point. So hopefully we'll have something fairly quickly after the first of the year.
Very good. All right. Who's doing the gift of real property? Brian, you doing that? Okay, very good, sir.
I got the short straw tonight. good evening, Commissioners. I am here to request permission to accept the donation of Swepsonville River Park from the town of Swepsonville. It is, for those of you not familiar with the park, it's a 20-acre park located on Boywood Road. It has hiking trails, access to the Hall River, two accesses to the Hall River, a Civil War historic site, and several of the county's champion trees of various species. Mayor Herring is here tonight from the town of Swepsonville, and he'll answer any questions you have. But while I'm up here, I want to take a moment just to recognize the mayor and all the hard work he's done on this park. He opened that park in 2004, built and opened that park. And when I say built it, I don't mean he hired somebody. He built it.
Give him
he takes
tractor
care of it. He's done it all at that park for years. And it's a serious job. I appreciate all the work that you've done. It's the most popular park on the Hall River Trail system, and it's a great asset. He has asked the county to help operate that park because of the limited resources they have at the town of Swepsonville. We're more than happy to do it and are excited to add it to our system.
Will it have any budgetary implications?
There are not a lot of initial costs at this point. The mayor's taken very good care of the park, and there's not much to do right off the bat. There's ongoing costs, which is mostly just our personnel going by and checking. That'll be pretty minimal. I'm not asking for any additional staff this evening.
Is this by any chance part of the trail that goes through the old golf course in Swepsonville?
No, it's on the other side of the river. This is on the west bank of the river. It's just south of Swepsonville-Saxbaha Road. It goes about a mile down to Great Alamance Creek along Boywood Road.
And this is consistent with our adopted trails plan?
It is. This part has, of it this is. Has been part of the Hall River Trail right. And a part of the Mountains of Sea Trail, accepted by the state as part of the Mountains of Sea Trail for several years.
Any other questions for Brian? Mayor, thank you very much for your offer here. I think this will be a great addition for the county to help it maintain. I know you do a lot of work down there. I don't know how you do it, but Swepsonville is very fortunate to have you.
I move we accept the donation.
Thank you, Bob.
I'll second that.
All right. Thanks, Phil. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Very good.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, we would later on we would like to do a special recognition for Swepsonville and Mayor Herring. So that would be
okay. That'd
so
be great.
We do appreciate the work that he's done and his tireless efforts, and we do appreciate it. Thank you, Mayor.
Very good. All right, review of the bonds for public officials, Susan.
Actually, Craig's going to handle that.
Craig, handle that one, okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I like the simple ones. This is required under the minimum requirements under North Carolina General Statute 58-72-20 for our tax administrator, the sheriff, our finance officer, registered deeds, and also Susan Roberts again as our TDA finance person.
Question on that. Why is the registered deed a different company? All of them are National Grange and one's Nationwide Allied.
I'm not sure exactly the reason for that, but I can find out and let you know.
Just curious about why we would use two bond companies.
Is this handled through the same broker?
I believe it is, but I can verify that for you.
Okay. All right. Well, I guess we will.
And again, TDA is the Tourism Development Authority.
Right. Are Are you finding out right this minute?
I'm texting Rhonda now, so I should have an answer by the end of the meeting.
All right. I guess we need to vote on this.
Yes, sir.
Take a motion to accept the bonds as presented.
I so move.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. Thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
Very good.
That's to protect the county.
No doubt about that. We need that. All right, Memorandum of Understanding for ACTA. Who's doing that, Craig?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Basically, what we have done in the past is ACTA receive some grant funding that is paid in arrears. So they don't usually have the cash to upfront the cost. It's usually about a 90 to 120 day period of lagging to get the revenues in. We've sort of served as their bank in the past, and basically we will upfront ACTA the cost of the grant, and then once they get receipt of that revenue, they'll pay us right back. And we have done this for the past couple of years.
And I would say, being on the ACTA board, that the executive director of ACTA would only request the amount of cash necessary, not request the entire amount of
right.
grant.
As needed.
That's correct.
Just kind of an as needed. And I would say this past year, once the federal dollars came to ACTA, the county was paid back just about immediately.
But very much so. We're kind of their safety net,
yeah.
is what we are, because, again, this is paid in arrears.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions about that? If not, I'll take a motion.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Very good. Budget amendment for the library, Ms. Wilkerson.
That's for big bucks, too.
It is.
Good evening,
Worth
Commissioners.
Good evening.
We just got our announcement of our state aid amount, and we never have that for the year when we have to submit our budget request. So I just got what was approved, and it happened to be $322 more than I submitted in our budget request. So I'm asking for a budget amendment to approve that extra $322 that I think will be put in our books, to purchase books.
Which five books are you going to buy with that?
Yeah, that's what I was getting ready. You know, when you talk at $300.
Maybe buy one.
That's right.
All right.
That sounds straightforward to me, so I'll make the motion.
Thank you, Bob. I'll second that. I'm with you on that. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay. Who else wants $300? Sheriff. You have a budget amendment.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm appearing for you tonight to ask that $105,896.45 be transferred from our federal drug seized assets to line item 4310602. $100,896.45 will be used to pay for the four vehicles that I said I would buy mm-hmm. from our federal drug assets, so the school system, give up two cars, and then we were buying two. $5,000, and we've got approval from the Department of Justice, can be used for what we call our Crime Stoppers of Alamance County. They are in very dire need of money with the shootings that are occurring in Burlington and around. A lot of information is obtained through our Crime Stoppers, and they make payments. So $5,000 of that amount would go to Crime Stoppers of Alamance County. I'm asking the Commissioners to allow me to do this.
I so moved.
I'll second.
All right. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
How's your hiring process coming?
Believe it or not, we way ahead of everybody else. But we still got seven, not out of the 10, but we've had some retirements in the jail, and we've had some to leave this out in the field. But I think we've got probably eight openings right now, somewhere along.
Okay. Now. Very good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Stepping up, Grant.
Good evening again, Commissioners. What we are asking before you now is to go ahead and allow us to budget for the $250,000 step and up grant initiative that we have received from the federal government at this time. That goes ahead and gets those funds on our books so that we can go ahead and account for expenses.
You want to make comments to what's going on with that, Bob? I know you've been working very hard.
This is from the Bureau of Justice Assistance, and it's going to be for over a two-year period, and it's primarily going to fund like overtime that our law enforcement agencies incur when they send their law enforcement officers to crisis intervention training. Crisis intervention training is a 40-hour program, so it's very hard to send your law enforcement officers to that. So this will help. So it's removing a barrier. So that's one thing. Another thing is that it's going to be paying for the two part-time co-coordinators to help keep this whole initiative running smoothly and keeping everybody engaged. I mean, this is a big deal.
And this is a two-year thing?
Yes.
I thought it was a three.
What, was it three?
Three.
I'm sorry,
years.
I misunderstood. And then the third thing is to help expand the co-responder program that the City of Burlington has to our Sheriff's Department. So when Sheriff deputies go out on a call and it's been identified as possibly a situation where somebody with mental illness is the so-called perpetrator, that a mental health professional will accompany the sheriff deputy to help defuse the situation and avoid an incarceration. So those are the three major components. Did I get them okay, Susan?
Yeah.
And we're very excited to have this grant. We had a technical assistance call this afternoon with the Council of State Governments, which the Justice Center, who is contracted with the Bureau of Justice Assistance to provide technical assistance to the grantees. There's a lot to the administration of this grant, but we're very excited to have it.
Any more questions? Same? Any questions?
Let me ask you another question.
Yes, sir.
At the end of those 3 years, mm-hmm. what's going to happen with those full-time employees?
I'm going to turn that over to Susan Osborne.
That's an excellent question.
It's our tradition with our grants is to start from the very beginning with sustainability, and so we will be creating mechanisms and processes that at the end of the 3 years those two positions won't be needed, and our position is that they go away at the end of the grant.
Okay,
that's right. Because one, it really takes this paid effort to help get everything rolling.
Yeah.
But once everything's rolling, then we shouldn't
kind of self-sustain.
That's what I was hoping.
Self-sustain. Yeah.
Okay. So I'll make the motion. We accept that.
Okay. Thank you, Bill.
I'll second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye. Thank you.
Very good. All right. DSS. Miss Susan.
So, good evening. We have another grant in front of you today. This is a Governor's Crime Commission and it's Family Justice Center. So Ms. Brady is here to answer any questions that you have. $571,000 over a two-year period with about $70,000 match that will be, $142,000 in match that will be made up in kind. It's not a cash match. You have a grant fact sheet that we've started doing. We have a lot of grants and a lot of different requirements, so we're preparing a grant fact sheet for you that kind of outlines the amount, the grant period, the personnel we're hiring. Mm-hmm. Once again, this personnel, our goal is to create sustainability in our processes. We do sometimes apply for extensions of grant, and if it's extended, we would keep the personnel beyond. For example, Governor's Crime Commission, our last grant initially was for 2 years and we got it extended to four.
Good.
So that's how that just kind of rolls. So the goals of this grant are listed. They're in keeping with our commitment to domestic violence in Alamance County and the growth and importance of the Family Justice Center. So be glad to answer any questions. Ms. Brady would, if you have any questions about the grant, but we would like to accept this into the DSS budget, 571045.
Well, I know Cindy and them have done a great job over there, and the whole state's kind of looked at that program.
They are.
And some are trying to emulate it, but it's hard to do.
Cindy has regular requests and regular visitors from other counties.
It's good work. Good work going on. All right.
I move that we accept the grant.
Okay. Thank you, Bob.
I second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right.
So the next budget amendment for DSS is much like MJ's. Instead of $322, so ours is $761,000. This is once again estimates we get, and when we get our final allocations, we put those into place. The biggest changes for you on this grant, on this budget amendment, we got an additional $500,000 in daycare, child care, which is a good thing. We still have a waiting list of about 500. We got some more Smart Start money, about $175,000 that we needed for child care as well. We had losses in our crisis intervention and our LEAP of about $100,000. That's our energy assistance programs. But if we don't have the money, then we don't fund the service. So that does not become a county cost. So these increased and decreased revenues offset with increasing and decreasing expenditures.
On the crisis intervention, what is that?
So that's our energy assistance programs, crisis intervention programs.
Oh, okay.
So it's federal dollars that we receive to help with cutoff notices and things like that for
so
cold weather and
that.
For hot weather. So we started that program December 1. It's been very busy with the cold weather. But it's some real strict criteria. Has to be a crisis, have to have a cutoff notice, and there's a limit to what you can help somebody with on a yearly basis. They're eligible for $600 in assistance, so it's not something that somebody can just come every month. Mm-hmm.
You know, I would say that anything that we can do to support early childhood education in our community is money well spent, because that is the most important time in a person's life
and absolutely
determining that success of that child.
Absolutely.
And, you know, we have this, these kids are bombarded with all kinds of forces from different directions, and some of those are positive and some are negative, and it's kind of like a balance. You want to outweigh the negatives with the positive ones. And when that happens, then that child's going to have a higher probability of success later in life. And some of those negative ones, like, you know, if a child's in a family with no heat, that could cause toxic stress, and that would actually inhibit the development of a child's brain.
That must have been what was wrong with me.
Had a little toxic stress.
Yeah.
Well, and to that end, there's some extra Smart Start dollars available right now. So we've applied for additional $160,000 to bring some more kids off the waiting list. Mm-hmm. So we may have another budget amendment very soon.
Well, I move we accept this budget amendment.
All right, I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Merry
Susan.
Christmas.
You too. Okay, Mr. County Manager.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Board. And what I would like to request is that we begin looking at a position of a public information officer for the county. During our strategic planning process, one of the things that we really heard from the people that attended was that they wanted to know more about what we did as county government. They want to know about the services we provided, about who we were, and about information that they felt like that they were not getting. They wanted us to do a better job of communicating with our citizens. Then that kind of bled over to County Government 101. One of the biggest feedbacks that we got from County Government 101 was we really did some really good and neat and inventive things, but they didn't know about it. And so we needed to do a better job about sharing who we are and what we do with the citizens in our community. One of the most proud things I have when Roger Parker was on the board, Roger, when we had to meet the commissioners, Roger said, I didn't realize that county government did all the things that county government does. And that's part of our fault. We don't share what we do. We don't share the programs. We don't share who we are.
And this is one of the things that I would like for us to begin looking at. Again, kind of the theme was we're the best kept secret in Alamance County, and we shouldn't be that best kept secret. We should be able to tell people what we do and what's available and how we can do a better job of communicating. And this is why I would like to recommend that we look at a public information position for the county. And here's some of the things. I've got a small slide presentation. Again, it goes back to our strategic plan. This is pillar 5, government accountability and resource management. And a commitment to provide leadership through innovative and effective management, promote trust by transparency, promote trust by providing transparency, openness, and appreciating citizen concerns. This is something, again, we've heard over and over again about we needed to do a better job in telling our story. Again, this is really about telling about the services and who we are and what we do. Here's some things, and there's a lot of tools that we have that we use, but we need to do a better job of using those tools. We do a better job, and we do a good job of our county website, and Scott Ward, who is our webmaster, has really done a good job. But Scott, that web design is only part of Scott's job. So we need somebody who can look at it from a county perspective. If the board will remember, we passed an agreement with the city of Burlington with the PEG channel, which is a public educational and governmental channel. And we are responsible for 6 hours of new programming each month. That's something we could do more of if we had the public information officer. We could do more streaming video, the Board of Commissioners meetings. We could do public service announcements. We could do a talk show. You name it. There's a lot of different opportunities that we could do. Again, we also, one of the things in talking with Debbie Hatfield, our emergency management coordinator, is how we get out communication with respect to emergencies. And we have the NICSL program. However, we need to do a better job of coordinating that and making sure that is being used to its fullest. But we also get a lot of requests for guided tours from school children to community colleges, to people for internships, just people interested in county government. They would like to have tours. The other thing is County Government 101, is to help Tori. Tori has done an excellent job in setting up County Government 101, but we could do a better job of promoting that and explaining to the citizens what we do. But also, if you look at the city of Burlington has a public information officer, we could do a better job of coordinating with them, and also the municipalities as it be seen as a resource, also working with the university. These are other things, I won't read them all, but we don't have a county newsletter, printed or email, and that's something we've talked about doing. Digital message monitors, social media. We do social media, but it's not concentrated. It's kind of hit and miss of when we do Facebook or Twitter. So by having one person kind of in charge and kind of vetting some of these issues, it would make our social media a much better tool. We also have county intranet, which is internet between county employees, that we could share more information between employees about what's going on. Again, citizen comments, citizen complaints could go through our public information officer. Again, I talked about NEXL and Alamance County Emergency Notification Services. One of the things we want to do is provide an annual report. Brian does an incredible, where's Brian? Oh, there's Brian.
He's the light man.
Brian does an incredible job when we look at our performance-based management final reports. But one of the things we've talked about doing is putting something much more comprehensive and much more in detail that we could do on an annual basis, and that's something we haven't done. News releases. We do a lot of really good things. Susan and her department just won an award. What was
the Best Practice Award for our work with food stamp recipients and helping them meet the new guidelines that say able-bodied adults have to go to work to get food stamps.
So we won that award, and we have to do a better job of sharing that. We have to do a better job of showing the citizens, you know, what they're getting for their dollar. So we need to kind of pat our employees on the back and let them know how important they are to us as well. Again, we get requests all the time for public speakers and public forums, telling them about county government, brochures, announcements, calendars, events. We need to do a better job about setting up calendars and events for people to check, public meetings, classrooms, presentations. You name it, there is so much that this position could do. Here's what we have so far with respect to social media. Alamance County Library has a Twitter, an Instagram, and Facebook. Parks and Rec has two Facebook accounts and a Facebook events account. Fire Marshal has Twitter. The county has Twitter and Facebook. Health Department has Facebook and Twitter, and Cooperative Extension Facebook and Twitter. One of the things that we've talked about is how do we integrate everything together, and how do you know what we're putting out there, how does the public know what we're putting out there, and how we can be more consistent with the good things that we are doing here in Alamance County. Scott, can you click, or Tori, can you click on, we'll just show you what our Twitter does and kind of the things that have been tweeted so far. Oh, that's okay.
There he is. He tweeted on out here.
See, we've already tweeted during the meeting, thanks to Hall River, that we've accepted the trail. Michelle Mills is doing this. But again, it really is kind of an immediate way that we can share what we're doing in county government to the public. Again, we the agenda, if you can't make the agenda, if you'll scroll on down, you can see some of the pictures. That was from last week. It's recognizing our 20 and 25 year and 30 year employees. Alamance of Cheese. So we do a fairly good job, but in the past, if department heads have had to be responsible, we're not consistent. And by having a person who is responsible, we can be a lot more consistent with our communication. So Scott, also, if you would hit the Facebook one. And then we have the Facebook page. Again, how many likes do we have? We have a lot. How many people following?
Scared, yeah.
That's a good question.
Yeah. There it is.
1,678 likes.
Wow.
So it's a really a good way to get out information. And again, to share information about the services that we provide in Alamance County. Again, by doing this, and I hate to come during the middle of a budget year, but we would like, the request is to move the money from contingency, which is budgeted for, to move the amount of $31,258 into the manager's line item, and that would cover 6 months. The thought process of moving this position forward in next year's budget is that each department, since there's going to be benefit from each department, that each department would put a couple $1,000s or whatever the percentage we come up with into this. You know, we pay for printing. You know, this is a service that we provide the departments. So we are going to ask the departments to say, put a portion of your budget into this position because you will get direct benefit from it. That's what I have.
Well, let me say, I'll be the first to say, I don't think we need to support this position. The time for positions to be added is at budget time. Of all people that in this county should understand that. as a county manager. I was against adding 10 deputies. Bob voted against it. That ain't the time to do it. The time to add positions is at budget time. No other time. I'm going to vote against this. I think it's a waste of taxpayers' money.
Yes, sir.
Well, I would just respectfully disagree that it's a waste of the taxpayers' money. But, Mr. Cunningham, how do you respond to that being added in the middle of the budget year? Why not wait until?
We've just seen the need now and the good things that it can do now, and the thought process was to try to go ahead and put it in with a 6 month. So, I truly respect your position on that and fully understand it.
One of the reasons I support it is, for one, you know, being a brand new commissioner, I brought the county strategic plan with me, and this is something that I intend to bring with me to every single meeting to remind myself of the county's priorities. And Mr. Honeycutt's right that it's a big priority for our citizens, our constituents, to provide transparency, openness, and a vehicle for our citizen concerns to be aired. Also, I think it's interesting and persuasive that the social media has no cost in itself. There's no cost to using Twitter. Facebook is free unless you choose to use it for to sponsor an ad or promote your thing, so forth. So I think that's very good. I think it's really good that this is a way to serve the citizens and the taxpayers and to let them know what's going on. I think they need to know what's going on now. If the money is there in the contingency, I think that they need to know what's going on now, and not, you know, we're at the beginning of the winter. This can be used for weather alerts and to alert people to, you know, to potential hazardous conditions and things. Tonight's public hearing, which was advertised in the newspaper, I'm sure that the law says that public hearings have to be advertised in the newspaper, but they can also be promoted by the public information officer, and that can be another way. Just because it has to be advertised in the newspaper doesn't mean that's the only way. You have to advertise it. The public information officer can have that as one of their responsibilities of making sure that people know what's going on. The agenda can be put out ahead of time. I think it's just a good way to connect the citizen with their government, and that's why I would support it.
So I would say I agree with Commissioner Lashley. You know, I'm generally the person who wants to follow the budget. That's what we have a budget for, and I believe in budgets. But I agree with Commissioner Gailey that this is an important position. I think that the public, we will serve the public so much better by keeping them informed, and informed in our way of informing them, and not rely on the media. Not that they don't do a good job, but they're in business to sell papers, and
they only get so much information, right?
And we don't want to be having to compete with other things going on in the news any given point in time. But I know I went to a lot of those public forums, and I heard that message over and over again, that people don't understand what county government is. I mean, I go out in the community,
right,
and they say, so what's a commissioner? And I said, well, we're the governing body of county government. Well, what's county government?
What do they do?
And I just think that would just, you know, it's really hard. Most organizations our size have an information officer. And like you mentioned, even the city of Burlington does. I don't know about the other municipalities.
They have two. Sheriff does.
The school system has an information officer. Even the PART board, on which I serve, the Piedmont Authority for Regional Transportation, has a public information officer. So I think you come up with a good plan to pay for this. And we're not adding to our budget right now. Hopefully we won't when it comes time to budget, during the budget formulation, if your plan of all departments, which are going to benefit from this as well, and promoting and carrying out their services, contribute just a little bit out of their budgets and to help pay for this.
It's an additional service that would be provided. So therefore, the thought process was to have them pay for it as well, for going to kind of pay for that use.
And even if that didn't work out, I would be in favor of including such a position in the coming year's budget.
I think that one of the things that Yeah, we appreciate now as the people turn to Facebook for basic news and basic information. And I'm thinking if I were in a crisis situation, if we had a situation in our county where emergency shelters were open and people needed to get to them in an emergency, how would they find out where those shelters are? Well, a lot of us have our smartphones, not everybody, of course, but people could look at Facebook very quickly and determine where they should would need to go.
Well, and also, Scott, if you'll click on the Facebook, Libby's public hearing notice for the changes to the, ordinances. Both ordinances were listed on both Facebook.
Welcome back, Scott. Twitter from back there, sir.
While Scott gets that, I just want to say one more thing, and that is, last week, was it, we had the new commissioner's orientation.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not a new commissioner. I didn't really have to come, but I wanted to come. It was a good refresher, and I'm so glad that I did. And I said afterwards that just coming and hearing all of our department managers come and explain what they do and the kind of services that they provide and the importance of those services, I just thought, I am so proud to be on the governing body of this organization called county government because of the quality of the people that we have. And the people, our citizens need to know that. And this is how we get the word out.
And if we do this, I would request that Michelle let people know we don't do roads.
That's a good idea.
Because, you get a request. I personally think that it is a needed thing, and as Bob said, a lot of about every organization has somebody that is a face for people that have questions. You have a lot of people following, but is our content out there that we need to have? And I'm glad Amy brought the strategic plan, because these people that I went to a number of those meetings, they appreciate what the county government does, but they look for information too about the parks and this and that. And I've talked to people and said, y'all have parks? And yeah, we do, and we got great parks. And I think that's part of what we need that for.
And respect to Mr. Lashley, I totally agree. If it wasn't that important right now, I would not be bringing it mid-year, but I really do respect your position on that. Yes.
And I'd like to make maybe one more little recommendation.
Yes, sir.
With this position is to work with Mac and them.
Mm-hmm.
Because this may drive the train that helps to bring in more industry, and if that happens, then we all benefit.
Yes, sir.
So.
Yeah, that's another thing that could be promoted, is what our involvement in economic development.
Yes.
And our involvement in public education.
All right. Any more questions, comments? All right. I'll ask for a motion to approve this or disapprove.
I'll make a motion that we transfer the funds from the contingency to fund the public information officer position from January through June 7, 2017.
I second that motion.
Okay. Thank you, Amy. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
No. All opposed?
No.
Okay. All right. Very good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. You could have just stood up there and read your report, Craig.
I could have. Let me just a couple things I did want to mention. Number one, I wanted to thank y'all for attending our luncheon last Thursday, our countywide employee Christmas luncheon. And again, appreciate everybody attending. And also want to thank HR for their exceptional work that they did in organizing and planning and staffing. And so we appreciate the work HR has done. Just a reminder that our offices will be closed on Friday, December 23rd through Tuesday, December 27th for our Christmas holidays. So wanted to wish.
23rd is Festivus.
Festivus for the rest of us. I have my Festivus poll already. So we're all good. But again, we will be open back for business on the 28th. So did want to remind you of that. Also, made sure everybody has on your calendar January 26th, which is our joint meeting with ABSS at 8:30 a.m. in the morning. And that will be at the library on Vaughn Road. Just want to make sure everybody had that.
Okay.
Craig, there was another meeting that was
facility meeting we're going to put
together? No, it was, and maybe it wasn't meant for the Board of Commissioners. I had an email from Marie Chavis because, you know, it's my position as a liaison, I'm on that mailing list, but she was announcing a joint meeting with the Board of Education and the North Carolina Legislative Delegation. And I thought that we attended that meeting last year.
We have, but we have not been officially invited. I think they wanted to do that separately this year because they wanted to have education issues.
All right.
What we will probably do with the board's approval is after the first year, try to schedule our own legislative breakfast with our delegation like we've done in the past.
Thank you.
Oh, and Susan has your answer on insurance.
All right, very good. Thank you, ma'am.
Rhonda Kangaroo. It is all under the Nationwide umbrella. That Nationwide then has underwriters, and National Grange is one of them.
I did want to also
remind you, our next meeting is scheduled for January 17th, and that is the Tuesday after Martin Luther King Day. So we will not have the first meeting January 2nd.
And it'll be on Tuesday instead of Monday.
Right. Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Right after Martin Luther King Day.
On Tuesday.
And that is all I have, other than, and follow Tony, I'll say Merry Christmas as well.
Very good.
Go, Craig.
Commissioners, any comments, questions?
I have just a few comments. Some things that came to mind after speaking to people during the campaign and beginning a new group of commissioners working together. I think that before we vote on something, it needs to be on the agenda. The item that we consider needs to be on the agenda, and that's, you know, happened tonight. But I understand that in the past that hasn't always happened. I think that Mr. Lashley's comments about the position for the public information officer are very appropriate and well-intended, and in which, you know, we're very prescient. That we shouldn't do things in the middle of the year. I think that my vote, you know, given the circumstances of the nature of the position, that's why I felt comfortable going forward with it. But in general, I think that we need to do things very deliberately. And when the board, this doesn't have to do with that particular position, but when the board votes on things that hasn't been on the agenda, it kind of gives the impression that we're making it up as we go along. Or we're not given the, especially important is giving the public the opportunity to comment and to be aware of what we're doing. And so if one commissioner makes a motion regarding spending money or taking an action when it wasn't on the agenda, then the public hasn't had notice of it and hasn't had the opportunity to comment or discuss it ahead of time. And the media hasn't had an opportunity to report it. Or to, you know, draw his attention to it. So I would just ask the commissioners to consider that point of view going forward, and not to, and this is not just, you know, not intended to be a criticism of any particular decision that was made in the past by any means. Perhaps his decisions would have been exactly the same if they had public notice and been on the agenda. But I think that this is just for moving forward. I'd like to ask if we can consider having a workshop to work together to have an update on the strategic plan and find out where we are with that and what's being done to implement the plan. I'm very interested in learning about that. I also like to have an update on the Stepping Up Initiative, which we talked about tonight a little bit, but just sort of to flesh out what that is really all about. And my understanding is that the Stepping Up Initiative has to do with encountering people who are mentally ill and how not to criminalize that,
right,
and how to help people instead of incarcerating them.
That's exactly
and
right.
That is that is so importantly connected to our society today in so many ways with it seems like ever-increasing gun violence and so forth. So I'd like to have more information about that as well. So I'd like to ask if we could consider having a planning session on how to move forward and consider adopting some guidelines, some customs of doing business.
I think that's a good idea.
I support that entirely. I'd even go further and say that when I went through my new commissioner's orientation almost 2 years ago at the school of government, they really recommended that boards adopt rules on how we do operate, how things get on the agenda. And
figuring out the proper way to go about this.
Yes,
too.
And yes. Because it can be, I agree, stuff can, if we allowed a commissioner just to kind of on an ad hoc, on a whim, make a motion mm-hmm. because it's, you know, an issue comes up and just wants to make a motion about that, that's not fair to the public. And now there may be times when for timing purposes it's necessary to take action. Sometimes things come up and you need to take action, or you forfeit a great opportunity or right. whatever it might be.
Sometimes you do.
Or there's some sort of requirement by the state right. that they need an action on something.
Exactly.
But those would be very
emergency situations.
Yeah, kind of emergency things. Yeah.
I think if there were an emergency, then the board could, have a motion to suspend the rules, yeah. and on agreement can do what needs to be done for
public
safety.
Just because we agree to something doesn't lock anybody's hands.
That's right.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. If I could ask, when would you like me to try to schedule this workshop?
Whenever it's good for me, I guess Mr. Sutton would need to be
okay.
consulted.
All right.
We'll confer with Tim and.
I'll put an email out in the morning, and
sometime
first
in January
of the year.
Would be fine, but I don't know.
Can I ask, were you going to be going to that new commissioner's orientation? And if so, do you know when it is?
I am going to go. I'm going to the one in Raleigh, so I don't have to go overnight, yeah. and it's in February. So it's kind of late.
Yeah, okay.
That wasn't ideal, but yeah. I didn't want to have to go away to Ashland.
It'd be nice if we could have that after we thought about it.
Yes, it would yeah. be. I'm looking forward to doing that as well.
We'll schedule it hopefully maybe before, since we're meeting late, we'll do it before that meeting. First part of January.
That would be great.
That'd be fine.
Okay. Oh, and also a reminder tomorrow at ACC, I think.
The bean signing? Yeah.
Did you get an email
yeah.
on that?
Okay. The bean signing. I've signed enough beans.
You didn't sign enough beans?
I've signed enough.
All right. Just wanted to remind you in case
okay,
you just missed
you.
That one.
Thank you.
Yeah, that would be good to do that, to schedule that first part of the year. All right, well, we've done a lot this year, and it's been a pleasure working with everyone. I wish everybody a Merry Christmas, Tony.
Merry Christmas.
You got it started.
I'm getting yeah.
Merry Christmas.
You getting? You are. Very good.
I need to wear my dress again, don't I?
No, leave that at home, sir. If there's nothing else, we'll call the meeting adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.